I'm afraid I've got some bad news.
I knew it. I love when he does that.
Well, once you hit rock bottom, the only way to go is up. So good luck. Okay? Good luck.
You say rock bottom, but like, it just seems like things keep getting worse. What is rock bottom? Who decides what's the bottom of all this? I mean, seriously, you go, okay, today is Friday, and I woke up in Cleveland, and I'm going, how much worse can it get?
Let's go. Ho! Uh-huh. Ho! You.
How many potties y'all gonna have over there? I'm gonna turn around. Potty, potty, potty.
I'm a hustler, baby.
Ho!
I just want you to know.
Ho!
I'll let you know. It ain't where I've been.
It ain't ho. Where I've been.
But where I'm ho. About to go.
Top of the world.
Now I just wanna love you.
Just wanna love you.
Wait a minute, I shouldn't be so high on that boy.
Hey, baby, come here.
Come on. Give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
When the Remy's in the system, ain't no telling when I f*** them, will I diss them? That's what they be yelling. I'm a pimp by blood, not relation. Y'all be chasing, I'll be placed dumb, huh? Drunk on crisp, money on E. Can't keep a little model hands off me. Both in the club, huh? Singing on key. And I wish I never met her. It gets better, ordered another round. It's about to go down. Got six model chicks, six bottles of Chris, four velvet ass, got whooped everywhere. What do you say? Me, you and your Chloe glasses. Uh-huh. Go somewhere private where we could discuss fashion, like Prada blouse, Gucci bra, okay. Filth Mark jeans, take that off.
Give it to me.
Give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
But don't foolish me.
Come on, give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff. That sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
But don't foolish me.
Mama, give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
Save the narrative, you saving it for marriage. Let's keep it real, ma, you saving it for carriage. You wanna see how far I'ma go, how much I'ma spend, but you already know. Zip zero, stingy with De Niro. Might buy you crisp, but that about it. Might light your wrist, but that about it. I might wipe you and buy you nice whips, mom, but you really gotta ride nice. Know how to work your hips and your hands priceless. Confess your love to Hov and I never let you down. Get you bling like the Neptune sound. Okay, hot hole, too hot to hold. Ladies love me long time like Tupac soul. Only way to roll, jiggering two ladies, I'm too cold. Motorola, two-way page, come on.
Give it to me.
Give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
But don't foolish me.
Come on, give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
So give it to me.
Give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
But don't foolish me.
Mama, give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
I'm a hustler, baby. I just want you to know. It ain't where I've been. But where I'm about to go.
Know me? I'm Will Smith, Jackie Robinson, Jay-Z.
Same song, I'm back, been around the world. Manson girls that dance with girls from Club Cheetah, the Club Amnesia, the Peanuts in L.A., bubbling in Dublin. Can't deny me. Why would you want to? You need me. Why don't you try me? Baby, you want to? Believe me.
Give it to me.
Give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
But don't foolish me.
Come on. Give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
So give it to me.
Give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff.
But don't foolish me.
Mama, give me that funk, that sweet, that nasty, that gushy stuff. Give it to me.
How's it going, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome to episode 271 of the Hoots Podcast. It is indeed our SummerSlam, our NXT TakeOver 36, the first dance preview podcast. No, it's just truly the nefarious brother Adam, a.k.a. Joshie Lopez, talking to you live in my good brother's studio in the north side of Chicago, Illinois. It's Thursday, August 19th, 2021. It's crazy thing. Like, time goes by so fast. It feels like yesterday I was in Orlando and they're ready for NXT Takeover in your house. Crazy how fast time goes by, you know? So, I was thinking about it the other day, like literally 2 months ago, I was using this new computer that I bought in Oviedo, record this podcast in my hotel room, and, you know, life brings you in a lot of different directions, and it's crazy how quick time goes by during that process, too. So life is good. There's a lot to discuss this week, ladies and gentlemen. And I also want to give a quick shout-out to the Nimrod on Twitter last week that told me that nobody listens to this podcast. At times, when I feel it's warranted, I could be petty. And I want to let that guy know, and the Sasha Banks crew know, thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for checking out last week's podcast, because it was the fifth most listened to podcast this year. And we're talking about numbers that's past 5,000 downloads in place. So thank you very much for telling me that nobody gives a you-know-what about this podcast, because you could be further and further away from the truth. I had a good chuck out there. Like, guy told me nobody listens to my podcast because, I don't get on my knees and kiss Sasha Banks' ass. That's not what we do here, ladies and gentlemen. I am not a person that comes here and fabricates opinions or anything like that. I'm off the cuff, for better or for worse. And I don't miss words. I don't say things for retweets and likes on social media. And I sure as hell am not going to come here and do hot takes just so I can get more YouTube subscriptions. By the way, if you do want to subscribe to our YouTube channel, it's youtube.com/thehootspodcast. If you want the audio version of the podcast, make sure to check out the Hoots Podcast at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Play. I think we're on iHeart Radio too as well, which is pretty cool. Make sure to check that out. And for those who are weekly listeners of the podcast, we do appreciate you a lot. And all you have to do basically is leave us a 4 or 5 star review on Apple Podcasts. And literally, more importantly, write us a review. Let us know what you like about the podcast. If there's anything you'd like to see changed, any constructive criticism, anything like that, we're open to open feedback for the Hoots Podcast. And we're 29 episodes away from reaching 300, which is absolutely insane in my mind. So thank you guys for the weekly support. It really does mean a lot to myself and Bert Carter, who's via satellite this week. That rat bastard. No, I'm kidding. you'll hear Bert Carter later on in the Thoughts of Dericho. And from what I've been told in advance, I think Bert Carter sent his longest clip for what the hell is wrong with AEW this week. So that's kind of a teaser of what you may expect for the segment later on today, because we had a rough night in Houston, and I'll leave it at that for now. Make sure to bookmark ProWrestlingTranscripts.com. Like I mentioned earlier, I've been like slogging away, just pumping out articles from five to seven different wrestling promotions a week. Impact has a special coming up that I'll be doing on Saturday morning. Of course, we got SummerSlam and Takeover as well, and just a lot of the weekly TV shows as part of the grind. So check out ProWrestlingTranscripts.com. And then finally, make sure you check out my work on the SME Network. I've been really having a lot of fun tapping into the analyst work and giving that a chance. You know, it's a little different for myself just coming out here being the host and having the back porch conversation with you guys. But going on a show like that with Andrew Baydala and Blake Mitchmore and have the opportunity to do analyst work and bring a different perspective to the modern wrestling media talk. It's been fun. I've been having a good time. I consider Blake and Drew to be really good friends of mine, and I hope it's reciprocated, and we have a lot of fun, and we've been getting a lot of good feedback, so I want to thank all of you who've been checking out our reviews and stuff like that. We got a big week of content for you guys, obviously with it being SummerSlam week. I think we're having a post-show for SummerSlam and Takeover. I'm going to be at AEW Rampage on Friday, attending my first ever AEW show. And again, this is good chuckle some people, because remember, I'm the one that hates AEW, right? It's gonna be a fun week of content, but more importantly, make sure you support those guys at the SME Network. Subscribe to their channel as well. It's a great network that I'm very fortunate to be playing a small role on, and very grateful for the platform. So support those guys. All right. Enough plugs, right? Let's get into the talk, right? We're going to start this bad boy off with the Good Brothers Q&A session as we do each week on the Hoots podcast. Basically what it is, if you have any questions, it could be about wrestling, it could be about life, it could be about sports, mental health, relationships, anything is on the table when it comes to the Good Brothers Q&A session on the Hoots podcast. And it's my time where I get to interact with you guys. And this is my favorite part of the show that we record each and every single week. So with that being said, let's get started. For those who would like to participate in the Good Brothers Q&A session in the coming weeks, all you have to do is send me a batch of questions on Twitter at Josh Lopez Media. Make sure to follow me on Twitter, by the way. I'm also on Instagram at JoshieLopez94. But you can also send me those questions either on Twitter or the Hoots Podcast at gmail.com, basically. So that's how you can be part of the segment. And we got our weekly contributors for our segment, Chris, Sam, and Nate the Great. You guys are awesome. I appreciate all three of you good brothers. You sent a lot of great questions this week. So it's going to be interesting. A lot of thought-provoking questions as well. So let's get into it, shall we? Let's see if I got anything here on the Facebook chat here. Let's start off with Brett here since he's on the Facebook Live here interacting with us. I don't want to ignore you, my man. He says, what match are you looking forward to at SummerSlam and TakeOver? I think for me, Edge and Seth Rollins is the match I'm looking forward to the most on SummerSlam. And then Walter and Dragunov is the match I'm looking forward to the most at TakeOver. And I'll explain why in the WWE segment later on. So that's a good question, though. There's a lot of good matches to look forward to this weekend at both shows. So it's going to be a fun weekend of wrestling pay-per-views, if you will. No. All right, we're going to start off with a good brother, Chris Zaletta at XTZaletta24X on Twitter. Make sure to follow him there. He's a good man, and he appreciate you following him and interacting with him on social media. All right. What up, Oops? Here's some questions for the Q&A this week. Does Tanahashi and Moxley happen at All Out? That's a good question to start off the bat here. Yes, I do think that match will happen at All Out. Either Tanahashi shows up on Rampage on Friday, or Moxley will show up probably in Milwaukee or wherever. Maybe Tanahashi shows up at the Dynamite show the week of All Out. You know, they're doing three shows in Chicago, so that's the thing. I mean, we're going to get to this later on, but honestly, outside of Pac and Andrade, do you have a reason to buy this pay-per-view right now? We're going to get into that later on. Oh, this is an interesting one. Who is Mr. SummerSlam? We always hear the conversation about Mr. WrestleMania, right? The Undertaker and Shawn Michaels. When I look back at it now and Mr. SummerSlam, I mean, you could throw out a Brock Lesnar. I mean, he did beat The Rock for the WWE title. He created Suplex City with John Cena. He had a classic match, in my opinion, with CM Punk. Retain in one of the craziest fatal four-way matches I've ever seen in my life, the SummerSlam match in 2017 with Roman Reigns, Samoa Joe, and Braun Strowman. Brock Lesnar would be the first one I would mention. I'm sure you could mention Seth Rollins or Edge as well. Would not be a bad choice. But I think for me, Mr. SummerSlam, is guys who've had most effective moments in there, it has to be Brock Lesnar. It might be, maybe I'm wrong in looking at it that way, but I really do believe it's Brock Lesnar. So, next question. Does Seth Rollins and Edge story continue at the SummerSlam? It just depends on what Edge wants to do. I think this is a one-off, and this gets to a boiling point where Rollins is so unhinged, he has to go to a different brand. We do have the WWE draft coming up soon. So, I mean, it could continue on Raw, but I'm not banking on it right now. So I would say that we're having a one-off here, and then little teaser for my prediction. I do think Edge beats Seth Rollins, and then it causes Seth to like lose his mind, and that's going to be a catalyst for him having to go to a different brand. So it could continue. We'll just have to see how that plays out. With Will Ospreay in the States, listed companies the other day on Twitter, who would you like to see him wrestle? Oh, boy. I mean, there's a lot of people I like to see him wrestle. I like to see him. I want to keep it to more of the New Japan Impact side of it than AEW, because I think the New Japan and Impact partnership is more beneficial for both groups right now than the AEW one. I'll say for New Japan, obviously for those who are on the New Japan Strong roster, love to see Will Ospreay against Fred Rosser. I think that'd be a good match. I know they're going to probably duke it up with Carl Fredericks at first, so that's probably a good match as well. I can't really say Jay White, because Ospreay and Jay White have already fought each other. I mean, it'd be cool to see it again, but you know, Will Ospreay against Brody King. Let's go to Impact. Let's see Will Ospreay against Eddie Edwards. Now, you got to think about this, too. Will Ospreay's a heel, so I can't put them all against heels and stuff that I would be interested in, you know. I look at Impact, you know, I like to see him again. Will Ospreay and Sammy Callahan would be cool. Will Ospreay and I said Eddie Edwards already, right? You know, Will Ospreay and Chris Sabin would be a good match. Or Will Ospreay and Trey Miguel would be a really good match. How about this one? Will Ospreay against Rich Swann. You know, we'll have to see how this plays out. But the Forbidden Door, ladies and gentlemen, everything's about the Forbidden Door, right? We'll have to see how this plays out. All right, here we go. Here's our first CM Punk question of the day. Has the potential of CM Punk's return have you less excited now because of the likely destination and the internet like it has with me? You know what, Chris? I'm going to bottle up all the Punk questions into one part of this Q&A session. So hold on right there with me, all right? The last question from Chris here, he says, for this week, he says, who are some players you would stay away from or don't trust this fantasy football season? Oh, man. Yeah, think about it. It's right around the corner. I'll say go on the low stock of Adam Thielen. I think the Vikings are taking a step back this year. I don't think things are going to work well with them this year, so I'll stay away from Adam Thielen. I always like to keep it towards the division, but, I mean, you can look at the other teams around the league. Maybe Darren Waller. He's a good tight end, but I don't know about the Raiders this year. That's a good question. I'm not really into the PPR stats and stuff like that, analytics with fantasy football, just like playing it. I don't really like dive deep into like who would be good or bad for your teams. Stumped me here. I would say like somebody like Mike Evans, maybe not. I mean, he does a good job with the Buccaneers, so we'll have to see how that goes. I have a couple options here and there, but I'd love to get your guys' thoughts on who would be bad picks for fantasy football this year. Brett asks, what do you think of Christian Cage winning the Impact Championship on Rampage? Indifferent. Don't understand it. Think it's fucking stupid. I don't know who in the right mind thinks that Christian Cage and Brian Myers would be a pay-per-view draw in 2021. But everything, like I mentioned a couple minutes ago, is about the Forbidden Door. So don't get me wrong, I liked the match with him and Olivier on Friday. But still, the fact is, you're debuting your second new show on TNT. And your first match that you offer is a match for another company's world championship when you could just done something to, I don't know, showcase your own talent. And yeah, I get it. They're in Pittsburgh. You want a bigger buzz and a bigger reception for Britt Baker? How about you have her debut and open Rampage instead of closing it? I have some issues with that, and I'm not really going to spend on Rampage this week. I'll maybe do it next week, but I just thought it was a missed opportunity, and the stuff with what's going on with the world title picture with AEW and all this stuff with the Forbidden Door is so convoluted that even I'm losing track of what's going on right now, because yeah, it looks like we'll have Olivier and Cage's rematch it all out, but honestly, do you give a shit who wins? Like, do you believe Christian's going to beat Omega again? And then, here's the thing. When Omega beats Christian at All Out, are any of you going to go on the soapbox and talk about the 50-50 booking, or no? We're going to get this double standard scenario. So, I love Christian. He's looked fantastic in the ring since he came back. But the fact of the matter is, this whole Forbidden Door concept is getting in the way of these companies actually building an identity, and I think it's a problem. And that's just my opinion. All right, next batch of questions is coming from the good brother, Sam Piopo, at Second City. Sam, what's going on, my man? Here we go. Interesting question here. What is your absolute most favorite part of the grind that is your weekly schedule? I think my favorite part of it is this, is recording the show for you guys. You know, I can bottle up any stress or things I'm dealing with in my personal life, and I can release that through the podcast. And it's very rare you find me coming on here and being spiteful and angry. Just in general, I like to have fun and make people laugh and think about things, but like, for me personally, this is like therapy for me. So I think that is a big part of my happiness when it comes to the grind of what I do each week is this podcast, is this segment, and interacting with you guys. You know, you make of what you want to make of your career. You know, with this territory, you have to sacrifice a lot of things. There's going to be weeks where you're not having a lot of sleep. And there's a lot of things that get in the way. There's a lot of things that it's a lot of time investing into this. And I spend around 60 plus hours a week covering this stuff in wrestling. And I do it for all of you. And the grind is real. It really is real. I think from a transcription standpoint, I feel like when I'm really in stride, where I'm not pausing every 5 to 10 seconds to get a sequence down in the match, I feel like I'm on top of my game and like I'm following along as the match goes on. That's always fun. Because for me, like I started doing the transcript because I want to be a wrestling play-by-play announcer. So I'll type it out the moves and sequences as if I'll call the match in my head. And it's coming off in the transcript, and I feel like I'm on my groove, and that happens a lot during the New Japan shows that I cover. And I love the challenge. You know, I love the challenge of, okay, here's a show that maybe if I was watching it as a fan, maybe I wouldn't have enjoyed it. You know, I wouldn't have enjoyed it. You know, a lot of people talk about Monday Night Raw being a miserable show to go through. For me, it's just another show to cover. I think a lot of the emotional ties that I have to wrestling as a fan is gone. So I don't need a show for it to be entertaining. I need something for me to grasp and learn something from it from a transfer standpoint. And wrestling now is work for me. I just don't look at it as just a fan anymore. But the grind is real. you know, doing like 4 or 5 wrestling shows the last couple of Fridays, it's been rough on me, you know. But it's been also giving the opportunity to sleep in on days that I wouldn't usually sleep in on. And it's just how you balance it. And I try my best to give you top-tier content, whether it's this podcast or my website. And I leave no stone unturned. And it's really the pressure I put myself to be the best in my craft, and I feel like I'm at a really high point right now in my career, and I feel like I'm about to take myself to the next level. But that's just part of the grind, and I appreciate this dog days where I'm earning my back backlog of knowledge that's going to help me down the road whenever I do start calling wrestling matches for a living or I just start working in the wrestling business in general. I love what I do. I'm very passionate about what I do. And for me, my favorite part of the grind is, you know, coming out here recording the podcast, but it's also the release that I get after I'm done with making a transcript, let's say for like a pay-per-view or something like that, or a really awesome match. There's nothing better than that for me. And for me, I love the challenge. I feel like I bring something different to the table, whether it's audio or in written form in this wrestling media game. And I'm very proud of that. I take a lot of pride in what I offer to you guys each and every single week. And I hope it resonates with you guys. I really do. I hope it resonates. I'm doing it for the betterment of wrestling fans and letting people know that you can enjoy wrestling for what it is without acting like you know it all. And for me, that's why I do this. That's why I do this. And I make no bones about it that I want to work in the wrestling business. So I don't see the point of me coming out here and dogging the entire industry 90% of the show, you know? So I love the grind. I've been doing this since 2013. It's going to be 9 years in March, which is insane. There's a lot that goes into it, and I would love to do a podcast one day or a video and break down the process of making a transcript and stuff like that. But I'm very proud of what I do, and I hope the content that I've been dishing out to you guys, whether it's on audio or on the SND network or the transcripts in general, has been resonating with you guys because I put a lot of time and thought into this stuff, and I want my work to stand out. And I try to make sure that whenever it comes to making a podcast and doing a transcript, I don't want to make it all about me. That's not why I'm in it. And I hope that resonates with you guys. So a little long-winded answer there, but that's how I feel. That's the grind and mental stuff that I put into this stuff. So I hope you guys understand what I'm saying with that. All right. Led Zeppelin or The Who? I'll go with Led Zeppelin. I'm not really a big Who fan. I mean, I like a couple of their songs, but I don't know. It's not something that I go out of my way to listen to a lot. Like, I'd rather listen to The Eagles or Tom Petty than The Who. But I always loved Led Zeppelin. They're an amazing rock band, so I'll go with Led Zeppelin. Next question, fried chicken or Italian beef? Sam, bro, you always know how to hit me good with the hometown questions, man. Shit. Fried chicken or Italian beef? I got to go with Italian beef or my dad's going to kick my ass. My dad works. He's like an entrepreneur in the meat packing industry. Like, he like sells like Italian beef and pizza puffs around the city of Chicago. And I had to go with Italian beef. I'm from Chicago. Of course I gotta pick Italian beef. Now, I can't go wrong with fried chicken. Now, and I'm not just talking about like Popeyes or KC and stuff like that. No, but there's good fried chicken in the city of Chicago. But if I had to choose one out of Italian beef and fried chicken, I gotta go with Italian beef. It's just part of the family thing. I'm half Italian as well, so I gotta go with Italian beef. You're hitting the fucking heartstrings, man. Like, it's like me picking out like what do I enjoy more, pierogies or waterfall? Like, come on, man. shit. Brett, thank you, man. I appreciate you for your concert. It really means a lot. I appreciate it, man. We've been doing this show since 2016. It's been a lot of fun recording this podcast. Yes. What's going on, Sarah? Thanks for checking this out. My dad like sells like pizza puffs, I think hot dogs, burgers, a bunch of shit. Like, he delivers all around the city of Chicago throughout the weekend. He's doing his stuff, man. I'm happy for him. He's living his life on his own terms, which is really cool. So, yeah, my dad's a busy man, just like me. I come from a family of hustlers. One thing you know about me is, one, I don't mince words. I follow through with what I say, and I work hard. That's what you got to know about me. So, next question. I'm gonna get you back for that one, Sam. Because like, really, that's like, why would you ask the Chicago what's better, like Italian beef or fried chicken? Like, come on, man. your overall thoughts on Jungle Boy Jack Perry? I think he's a good athlete. I don't know anything about him personally, so I'm not really going to speak on that. I do think his wrestling style at times gets very generic. I think he needs to get away from the Jungle Express, get away from Dino Douche and Stunted Growth. Yeah, I just think Jungle Boy needs to go off in his merry way and do his own thing. So let's see what we got here. And I want to enjoy Jungle Boy, but there's a lot of parts of him that I feel like he's like generic in the ring. It's like, how many times am I going to watch a wrestling match where somebody does like the slap to somebody's chest and does like a lucha libre arm drag, drop kick, enziguri? It's like, I want to see something different in these wrestling shows. And it's like, every match has a pump kick. Every match has an enziguri or somebody falling off like the ropes, right? Like, you know, sometimes like Dean Ambrose or John Moxley, whatever you want to call him, he goes back on the ropes. Boom. Like this rebound clothesline. I've seen a lot of repetitiveness in a lot of these wrestling matches these days. It's hard for me to pinpoint who's coming out or who's making themselves unique when y'all are ripping off the Young Bucks. And you guys know me, I hate the Young Bucks. So I want to enjoy his work, but I find his stuff to be very, very repetitive. So we are in the middle of our Good Brothers Q&A session right now, where I'm taking questions about wrestling, life, mental health, or relationships. And we're having a lot of fun so far. Let's continue on here. Top three favorite SummerSlam matches in your lifetime. I'm glad you said that. In my lifetime. I've got to be very specific here. Brock Lesnar and CM Punk from 2013 is up there on my list. John Cena and AJ Styles from 2016. I could be correct or wrong. You never know. I think it's 2016, but the AJ Styles and John Cena match, I think it was a singles match that year, or it could be for the WWE Championship. But either way, that match of John Cena and AJ Styles from 2016 was absolutely insane. And then I had to go with one that I think the original TLC match was probably up there as far as one of my favorite SummerSlam matches of all time. Folks kind of forget about that. The first TLC match happened at SummerSlam 2000. It was not WrestleMania 17. The first TLC match was at SummerSlam 2000. So I got a question here for Sarah. She says, how would you give advice to someone who didn't want to be alive anymore? Oh, boy, we're getting tugging the heartstrings here. Shit. That's another like full show that I have to do for another time, but I think the easiest thing to pinpoint is, it's really something where you have to go dig deep down deep within yourself and ask yourself, what's your purpose right now in your life? And I know we all go through different situations and we all deal things in our own way, but you have to ask yourself, what is within your purpose right now? Obviously, faith with God is a given, so it's really something that we don't really need to talk about. But I think for me, living within your purpose is very important. And I know, I understand things bottom out for people and shit happens, but I'm never going to advocate or try and convince somebody that not living anymore is a good option. I just don't see the point of that. There's days where I feel empty and I feel worthless to a lot of people, but I'm not living for them. I'm living for me. My happiness is not going to be dictated on what somebody else does to me. My happiness and my purpose in life is what I'm doing and what I feel inside and what's best for me. And that just comes from my fact of me being independent and living on my own terms. I don't feel as empty and downtrodden like I was when my parents got divorced, you know? At that time period, no, I did not want to live anymore. But I did something about it. I found something that made me happy and gave me a purpose to continue on. So I'm never going to advocate for somebody to be like, oh, okay, yeah, just go ahead. Don't live anymore. Don't live anymore. You got to find something within you and what your purpose is and stay true to that instead of worrying about how things are going to happen from other people, because you can't rely on anybody. The only things you got to rely on in life is yourself and God. That's it. You can't expect anything. For me personally, I expect absolutely nothing from anybody on this planet. I don't expect anything from people that I'm interested in having a relationship with. I don't expect things from my friends. I don't expect things from my family members. I don't expect anything from anybody, because I've been burned too many times to expect anything from anybody. So it's just how you go about it. And I have to stress this point to everybody that's listening to this week. Stay true to your purpose. You got to stay true to your purpose no matter what. You just have to. You have to. All right. Next question. If you could relive one moment in your lifetime, what would it be? Oh, man. I want to keep it positive for this question. For me, if I can relive one moment, for me, it would be the day I got to perform at the orchestra hall. Take a quick swig of water there. It'd be the moment where I got to perform at the Chicago Symphony Orchestra Hall downtown when I was in elementary school. I was on cloud nine. I felt like I was top of the world and nobody could say anything to me. Like, just that feeling of playing music on a big stage like that is something that you can't replace. It's from a performance standpoint and an entertaining standpoint, like, it's just a high that you want. I think those who do broadcasting like I do or work in any field of entertainment will relate to that. When you're on a big platform, you're on a big stage like the orchestra hall downtown, just that adrenaline that comes inside of you is something that is a high that's better than most things in life. And for me, that moment was very, very special to me. I got to play be part of a All City Elementary jazz band when I was like 12 or 13 years old. It was like 7th or 8th grade, right? And this is when I first started playing guitar. And I got blessed from God. I'm not going to come in here and tell everybody that I'm the greatest guitar player or anything like that. But I got to learn how to play guitar from my grandfather, from my mom's side of family. And I caught up to it really good. And I did really well playing music in my school days. And that's the time in my life that I really enjoyed. It's something that I think about a lot because I always loved playing music and getting to play these like Navy Pier. I got to play at a festival at the United Center before. I got to do a lot of cool stuff in music, and that's probably up there is like the one thing I would love to relive. Now, is there things that I regret or things I would take back? No. I don't live with regret. I don't live with regret. I understood every decision I made for better or worse. I don't regret going to Oviedo the first time and having my heart being fractured. I had to go through that experience, you know. Honestly, that experience brought me to where I am right now. And the fact that I believe in myself and that I have me, and that's all I need. I don't need to sell myself to another woman for the sake of labeling ourselves into a relationship. I'm not selling I ain't selling myself to anybody. I don't have to. I know damn well the type of man I am, and it's so high and above the people that are considered men or high value these days. It's not even close. So for me, I don't live in regret, but I like to like relive the positive moments I had, or like the first time I played high school football at Ronner, stuff like that. Or if I can relive the time where I was at Money in the Bank when CM Punk beat John Cena for the WWE title. If I could be back there, that 17-year-old kid being at the Rosemont Horizon, seeing that epic moment, like, I would love to see that. That'd be awesome. That's a great question, man. I really do. Are you worried about the Bears' offensive line? I wouldn't say that I'm worried. I'm not worried about the interior of our offensive line. I think we're fine there. It is disconcerting what's going on with the tackle position. I know they signed Jason Peters the other day, but again, offensive line, Just Fields or Andy Dalton, all that does not matter if Matt Nagy doesn't fix his shit when it comes to play calling and strategies throughout the week. Like you know, we can get these debates about Andy Dalton or Justin Fields. Should Andy Dalton start week one? Should Justin Fields start and start playing right away? For me, that doesn't matter if your coach is not doing his job. You know, everybody wants to use Mitch Trubisky as a scapegoat for the Bears' problems over the last couple of years, but not really paying attention to the main issue of the football team, and that's the head coach. So we'll have to see how that goes. Brett asks, what era of wrestling did you start watching wrestling? I started watching wrestling 1998. I was 4 years old. So right in the middle of the Attitude Era, that was when I started watching wrestling. I'm old. I just turned 27 a few months ago, which is insane to me. All right. If you had the number one overall pick in your fantasy football draft, who would you take? Good question. Riveting question here, pal. I would take either Patrick Mahomes or Christian McCaffrey. Christian McCaffrey is one of the most underrated players in NFL, but he's a beast when it comes to fantasy football. So that'd be one of the first people that I would pick, either Patrick Mahomes or Christian McCaffrey. Last question for Sammy says, one woman in NXT. Oh, damn you, Sam. You brought it this week, brother. You're really zapping me with these questions, man. One woman in NXT, WWE, and AEW that you would love to take on a date. My man. I'm thinking like that Denzel Washington gif that you see on Twitter. My man. My man. all right. NXT. I'll go to NXT UK. I'll pick Blair Davenport. WWE. I'll go with Liv Morgan or Bianca Belair. That would be my pick from there. And then AEW. I mean, for those who listen to the podcast, you guys should know already who I'm picking, right? It's Penelope Ford, and it's not even close. My God, that girl's on another level. Those would be the ones that I'd pick. I mean, there are a lot of beautiful women, so I'm not going to try to discredit the women out there. But like, if I had to choose like who I'd pick for those shows that you're talking about, Sam, those would be the ones I'd pick. And Penelope Ford is still number one as far as like my wrestling women's crush right now. It's not close. So let's see. Oh, man, we've been having a lot of great questions this weekend. I'm saving the CM Punk questions towards the end of the Q&A here, so stay with us, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to get to that in a couple minutes, but we do have a couple more questions here on the podcast, and it comes from our good brother, Nate the Great. He sent a lot of questions this week, so here we go. Mr. Fob on Twitter, by the way, at Psycho Nagiri. He says, what do you make of the age of the story of a wrestler coming back from injury claiming to be the real champion? And do you think Shingo and Ospreay will do it any different? Well, I found Ospreay's promo at Resurgence to be very interesting. And I like Will Ospreay, and I think he's a good wrestler. But his promo sometimes can be hit and miss. I think he overcompensates by cursing to make himself look good on the microphone than actually say something that's important to what's going on to the story. Obviously, I'd be down for another match with Shingo and Ospreay. It sucked that Ospreay had to be stripped out of the title because of the neck injury. But for him to call Shingo an interim champion was pretty funny. And then hearing Kevin Kelly's reaction, you're gonna say his championship is a fake interim title? Like, I love Kevin Kelly. He's the man. I'm curious to see how this play out because Ospreay said he's not going to go back to Japan until he gets his match with Shingo. So we'll have to see how that plays out. But it's going to be interesting. I mean, we got unhinged Will Ospreay now. I think he's probably bummed out that he's not getting to fight CM Punk now. But let's see. Maybe that'll change because of the Forbidden Door. Way too early Wrestle Kingdom predictions. This could tie in something with the G1 coming up. I think Shingo is going to fight Naito at Tokyo Hall, at the Tokyo Dome. You just heard it right here first, folks. I think it's going to be Shingo and Naito, an LIJ battle for the World Championship at Wrestle Kingdom next year. I think that's what's going to happen. As far as other ones, I would really love to see Ishii in a high caliber match. I don't know against who. If you're not gonna have Ishii in a high caliber match, I don't want him in the battle royal or these like long 6-man tag matches. Like give Ishii a goddamn singles match on the show. Have him fight anybody. Have him fight Moxley 1-on-1 or Suzuki. Have somebody from Impact or AEW show up and fight Ishii. I don't want Ishii to be buried in the fucking mid-card and the New Japan Rambo that they do for these big Tokyo Dome shows. Like, give Ishii something interesting to do. He's one of your best performers on the roster, and you always have him stuck in the tag division, and it's, like, ridiculous. How would you like to see the G1 done this year? The same way it always is. I think the G1 Climax Tournament that New Japan presents every year is the best tournament in professional wrestling, and they do it right. This is going to be, I think, my fifth G1 that I've covered. This is going to be my fifth G1 Climax Tournament that I've covered this year, and it's going to be wild in September and October, folks. I can't wait. It's going to be wild. I am going to try to plan to reach out to a buddy of mine who's in the wrestling media. His name is well known to those who watch New Japan Wrestling a lot, a young man named Chris Samsta. I think it'd be really cool if me and Chris came out and did a preview of the G1 for you guys. I think that'd be awesome, right? Me and Chris Samsta doing a preview of the G1 tournament. I think that'd be awesome. Just an idea up there. I will reach out to him, see if he'd be interested in that. But I would like to see that go down. All right, 1 second here. Who would you like to see win the number one contender match for the Impact title? I'd like to see Ace Austin win. I think that'd be a cool pick. But if that choose number one, I'd probably go with Sami Callihan. Should they retire the TNA heavyweight title? Sure, I guess. I don't know why they brought it back. Like, I wasn't crazy about it when Moose was walking around with it. I know he was doing it for heel purposes, but it didn't mean much to me. So, yeah, they should get rid of it. If the Forbidden Door is open, would you like to see any juniors from New Japan Pro Wrestling challenge Josh Alexander for the title? Oh, of course. I would like to see Hiromu Takahashi against Josh Alexander. I think Alexander against El Desperado would be a good match. I already mentioned Hiromu, right? I think Josh Alexander and El Fantasmo would be a good match, or him against Ishimori as well. That would be a very good match. Of course, I would like to see some juniors go after him. And then Tracy, that... What are juniors out there that could work well with Alexander? I have to give them more time on Strong and see where it goes, because they have a lot of good, talented young lions, and they have to get their name out there more. But if you want somebody else out there that's a really good, talented wrestler that maybe you want to classify him as a junior, I would love to see Josh Alexander against Danny Limelight. Danny Limelight, a.k.a. the Barrican Oost. What's going on, man? I would love to see Josh Alexander against Danny Limelight. I think that'd be an awesome match. All right, more questions. What match do you think would be talk about the most for the weekend coming Monday morning? That's a great question, Nate. I think it's going to be either Roman Reigns and John Cena or Walter Dragunov. I'm really excited to see the atmosphere for the Roman Reigns John Cena match. It's going to bum me out for the fact that I won't be in Las Vegas for SummerSlam. I would really love to be there and cover the event as part of the media, but didn't work out this time. But yeah, I think Roman Reigns and John Cena or Walter and Dragunov from Takeover will be the one we'll be talking about the most. Who's more ready for the main roster, Dakota Kai or Karrion Kross? I think Karrion Kross. I think Dakota Kai is going to be a fantastic addition for the Raw SmackDown brand whenever she does decide to go up there. But I think Karrion Kross right now is the more tailor-made guy for that element, that style of wrestling. So that would be my pick. Will NXT going back to the taped schedule format benefit them? I mean, I like NXT for what it is. NXT UK is obviously taped each week, so it's a fun one-hour show. They can tape it that way. But NXT being 2 hours, would the format benefit them? I really don't know. Because I really don't notice that much of a difference when the show is taped and live. It just depends on how much longer they still want to use the Capitol Wrestling Center. I know things are still going crazy with this COVID stuff, and now everything's about a variant, right? Like the Delta variant, that's what they're calling it. I have to see how that goes, you know what I mean? who knows? Who knows? Let's see how that plays out. Last two questions for Nate. He says, should you ever keep toxic people around? Quick answer, no. It's not worth your energy. I'm not going to spend energy on somebody who has no self-awareness and somebody who's so emotionally unstable that they can't look within what their actions are. You know, I'm not gonna waste my time with that. You know, I'm really not. There's no reason. I don't care if you're a family member or my wife or whatever. I'm not going to deal with toxic people. Cut the fucking attitude. I just say that tomorrow's not guaranteed. And there's something that's bothering you. You need to heal from it. Like, stop holding things off and using that as a defense mechanism or a reason to feel sorry for yourself. Address your issue and move on and grow from it. I have no room for toxic people in my life anymore. I just don't. What is more important to you, professional success or internal happiness? Man, that's a interesting question. Oh, man. What? Internal happiness or personal, professional success? Man, I think for me, I think right now with where I am in my life right now, I think professional success is where my head's at right now. As far as my personal well-being and happiness, I have all I need right now when it comes to that because I have me. I'm living on my own. I'm living on my own terms. So it's really something that it's not really something that I need more of. I think what's more important to me right now is the professional success because it's giving me a purpose. Like I mentioned earlier, I'm staying true to my purpose. I'm sticking true and going after my goals and dreams. So I think professional success in that is what's driving me now. I'm not in a relationship. I'm not seeking one right now. I'm not going to try to reach out to Lori and try to fix the issue that I didn't cause a fracture, you know. It's wild, you know. Tomorrow will be two months since I closed that chapter of my life with Lauren. And right now, my focus, my intentions, my focus, and everything within me right now is what I'm doing right now in my career. So am I Bad for saying that? Am I bad for saying that I'd rather put my professional success or my eternal happiness? I don't think so, because for me, I am happy. I'm in a good place in my heart. I'm in a good place in my life right now, so it's not really a lot for me to be upset about or angry. I mean, I have my own apartment. I'm living on my own terms. I'm not dealing with anybody's bullshit. I'm very fortunate with what I have in my career, and I'm very happy with the success of this podcast and the website. So I really have nothing really to worry about, you know. Like I'm not allowing a flaky woman or a woman who can't decide whether or not she wants to get over her ex or her drug related friends. Like I'm not worried about this shit anymore. I'm not. So like what's more important to me right now is the professional success and me reaching my goals, because no matter what happens, I already know that I have myself. I've been thrown so many monkey wrenches in my life that like I'm kind of numb to when things don't work out for me. So the satisfaction, that feeling when things do happen, it means much more because I already have myself. I'm living within my purpose. So yeah, I'm living within my purpose. So I think for me right now, current day Joshie, what's more important to me right now is professional success, because I'm not going to be dependent on whether a woman wants to be with me or not. I'm not going to try to give my heart again to another woman unless she deserves it. Like I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to sell myself for another relationship. If it's something with me and I just have sex here and there with people, awesome. But my focus right now is myself and my career. And that's it. And that's where my focus should be. I've been burnt too many fucking times to be like, okay, if I don't have enough happiness, then I have no other purpose of being here. No. I sat in a path 2 years ago after I got rejected, and that I have myself and I'm all that I need. And I'm not dependent on other people. You have to earn a place inside of here. I'm not giving that shit out for free. I'm just not. I'm just going to be keeping it 100 with you guys. This off the cuff. I'm not lowering myself to be in a relationship that's going to bottom out. Like, if it's not the real deal and it's something that I don't feel inside of here, I'm not going to waste my time, and I'm not going to waste that person's time either. So for me, of course, I'm going to have more happiness of, you know, me reaching my goals because of the hard work I put into the stuff that I'm doing right now. You know what I mean? So that's how I'm looking at it. Brett asks here, if you had the power for one night to book a wrestling show on any company, what do you mean? What card would I do, or what company would I have the power over, Brett? I don't really get the question, man. Yeah, but I mean, maybe I'm looking at it the wrong way, but that's how I feel. Just being honest with you guys, like, if I had more personal success with my career right now, I think that's it'd be more important to me, because I know if things don't work out, I still have myself, and I think I'm comfortable within my own skin in saying that. You know what I mean? So we did get a lot of questions this week about CM Punk, and I'm going to run them down here, and then I'll get into this. This will be the last part of our Q&A here. So 4 questions here for Nate. He says, why do you like CM Punk besides the fact that he's from Chicago? What made you connect with him? What do you think his best title reign was, and what was your favorite? What was your favorite gimmick/incarnation of CM Punk? And then Sam had a question about Punk. He said, if CM Punk does show up in Chicago on Friday, tell me everything you'd like to see him do in AEW. And then there was another question from Chris earlier about whether I feel less excited over the over-speculated buzz of him showing up. Has that taken the luster of my excitement to see him? And all these are great questions. I've been asked a lot about CM Punk over the last couple of days, and I haven't really had a chance to expand on it on this podcast over the last couple of weeks. I've been kind of pushing it off till this week for a reason. And there's a couple of reasons why to it. And CM Punk is my whole time idol. And for me, it's been an interesting 7 years since CM Punk last showed up at a wrestling show, which was, you know, he left the WWE in Cleveland, Ohio in 2014. And it's been kind of interesting and emotional for me, too, because I remember that day like it's yesterday, because that day when CM Punk left the WWE, it was my first day of doing transcripts. It was my first day in the wrestling media of doing transcripts and result pieces. Yeah, my first night of doing articles, my favorite wrestler quit wrestling. And now here we are, 24 hours away of him possibly showing up at AEW Rampage at the United Center tomorrow. And I wanted to talk about this in the beginning part of the show instead of the what the hell is wrong AEW segment, because I need some time to think about this and talk out loud with you guys about this, because at this point I still don't know how to feel. To address the elephant in the room, am I upset that CM Punk is going to be showing up in AEW instead of WWE? No. For me, I've always been about what Punk wants to do personally over what I want as a fan. Certainly would love to have this conversation with my big bro, Adam Daly, about this. I mean, we're both Punk guys, right? So Punk is my all-time favorite wrestler besides The Undertaker. I think a lot of us as wrestling fans have different feelings when it comes to, you know, when our favorite wrestlers show up and how we go about that, how we feel about that, that type of situation. It's been 7 years. And I think it's also very telling that in 7 years, the most thing that people are buzzing about is about hearing the promo that we heard 10 years ago. If that doesn't tell you about the state of wrestling fans and wrestling media as a whole, I don't know what else to tell you, because I'm not going to come here and tell you that CM Punk's not going to not do good business for AEW and that AEW won't catch good momentum ratings-wise with him showing up. Of course they are. Of course they're going to do good business. But after Punk does his inevitable pipe bomb part 3, right, in AEW, what's next? And that's what my concern is. He could show up to AEW. I don't give a shit. I really don't. I mean, he does what he wants to do, right? For me, I feel like him going out to AEW and just doing the pipe bomb promo and playing the hits, it's a miss for me. I'm just going to be honest with you guys. Like, after he cuts that promo, what's next? And for me, I think it would be a cool way for him to end his career if he, like, went back to Ring of Honor, or he did something in New Japan. And for me, let's go down these questions, right? Excuse me. Start with Nate here. He says, why do you like CM Punk besides the fact that he's from Chicago? I like CM Punk, the person, because I feel like I relate a lot to him in the fact that I don't care what people think about me. I live on my own terms. I have that DIY mindset, and that, and also I love proving people wrong. I get that a lot from CM Punk. I thrive on proving people wrong. I really do. I thrive on proving people wrong. And, you know, the big life lessons he mentioned in his movie, his documentary that he did with WWE. You know, if I'm not getting what I need for somebody, I'm just going to go on and do it myself. And I think that's a big reason why I've always looked up to Punk, why he's a hometown idol for me. So that's why I'm a big, big CM Punk guy. What do you think was his best title reign? What was your favorite? I think the 434 tirade is, I don't think that's going to be topped. So that'd be the easy answer to that question. That was his best tirade. What was your favorite gimmick / incarnation of CM Punk? Straight Edge Society, CM Punk, because I'm straight edge, and I don't think you see better organic heel work on wrestling TV in the last 10 years since CM Punk did the Straight Edge Society group. Yeah, that was my favorite incarnation of CM Punk. And then we had a question from Chris. My bad. He had a question here from Sam. When CM Punk does show up in Chicago on Friday, tell me everything you'd like to see him do in AEW. I want to hear from him, and I want to come in here and preconceive where he's going to do a pipe bomb promo or not. I really don't care if he does or doesn't. You know, that's not my concern. I just want to see what where his head's at and why he's back and what he wants to do. That's the main thing. Is there matches and programs I'd like to see him in? Sure. I put it out on Twitter. I'd just love to see him beat Kenny Omega for the title and just push Kenny Olivier to this side. I'm so tired of him. But, I mean, him having a match with Darby Allin would be cool. I would love to see CM Punk against MGF. I think that'd be awesome. I think that'd be some really good business there. CM Punk against Hangman Page would be pretty cool as far as a wrestling match is concerned. I'm trying to see what else on the show. I mean, CM Punk against Pac would be cool. Some of the guys he didn't really have a chance to have more matches with in the WWE because he left by the time they came up to Raw or SmackDown, you know what I mean? You know, I'd love to see maybe have CM Punk and John Moxley get into it. I think that'd be cool. I know a lot of people are saying, y'all, let's rerun CM Punk and Bryan Danielson. That'd be fine, but I just feel like a lot more times when we get to these fancy booking scenarios, it's like more that vibe of AEW being just a dirt cheap promotion. It's like, great. We got a show on TNT that's centered around message boards and Fightful select subscription people. That's the creative of AEW. That's what it is in a nutshell. That's the identity of AEW. It's like, okay, here's concepts that we've read on the internet and here on wrestling podcasts over the last 5 to 7 years, and this is what we have to present to you on TV. And I have no interest in that. That's not being an alternative. That's just being a mark. So those would be probably the ones that I'd like to see CM Punk do if he were to show up at AEW. And then last question for Chris, he says, has the luster of CM Punk showed up been lessened by the over speculation aspect of it? And I agree. I talked about this with Drew and Blake a couple weeks ago when I did the AEW Dynamite review with those guys. I was like, CM Punk's my all-time favorite wrestler, but I'm not going to come here and lie to you guys. Like, when he does show up, it's going to be a special moment for me. It's going to be a special moment for me because my favorite wrestler is back in wrestling. But I don't know how I'm going to be able to tap into the atmosphere of that moment because there's been so much scuttlebutt about it where that initial shock factor, that surprise element, is not going to be there for me. Because it's either he does show up or doesn't show up factor now. And I want to embrace that moment for what it is. And for me, I just hope it works out for what it is for him. If it's a special moment for him, then it's an awesome moment for me. But I just feel like the bloom is going to fall off that luster really soon after he cuts that initial pipe bomb promo, and I hope CM Punk does something different. I really do. But him coming back to wrestling is a good thing. I'm happy for him. If that's something that he wants to do for himself. And, you know, I think for me, this is going to be a special moment. It's why I'm going to the United Center tomorrow night. And We'll have to see how this goes. CM Punk will always be my all-time favorite wrestler, and him showing up to AEW is not going to make me change my opinions on him or anything like that. I'm not that'd be stupid. I just want him to do something different. I want him to enjoy his time for himself, and I'm curious to see how this plays out. It's going to be a special moment, and I'm glad that I'm going to be there for it, and it's going to be a fun night, so we'll see how that goes. But I want to thank all of you guys for sending awesome questions this week for the Good Brothers Q&A session. All you have to do is always is to hit me up on Twitter at Josh Lopez Media, or you can send your questions at the Hoots Podcast at gmail.com. Pretty simple. That's all you have to do. So I want to thank Brett, Sarah, Chris, Sam, and Nate for your questions this week. And when we come back, it'll get to what happened this week in WWE right here on the Hoots Podcast. Yes, sir. All right, folks, welcome back to the Hoots Podcast. Ready to get into what happened this week in WWE. I'm going to keep the thoughts from Raw and SmackDown kind of brief because we got a lot of matches and predictions to make right now in the wild world of wrestling. So we're going to breeze through this as fast as we can and then get you to what everybody's waiting for, our main event segment of the week. So with that all being said, let's get into it. Raw and SmackDown this week. I thought SmackDown, again, was another solid show. I wouldn't say it was great or horrible or anything like that. That was a pretty solid show from top to bottom. The John Cena-Roman Reigns back and forth was just some top-tier stuff, man. And, I mean, we could go through the whole roll call of the digs that they went towards each other. And Roman saying that the missionary wasn't enough for Nikki Bella. I thought that was interesting. That department. I had to tie this in from NXT as well. Index got engaged this week, so congrats to Indy Hartwell and Dexter Lumis. And secret congratulations. Congrats to John Gargano and Candice LeRae announcing the confirmation of their baby coming soon. So congrats to both of them as well. But it's so funny. They did the whole proposal right on NXT this week. And then they aired a commercial of John Cena in NFTs that they're selling. I'm like, that's a bad omen. Like, you have Indy Hartwell and Dexter Lewis getting engaged in Orlando, which happens to be the same city that I was in when I saw John Cena propose to Nikki Bella. And I'm like, bad karma. Dude, I tell you, folks, and those who know me very well, Central Florida is not the place to fall in love or get engaged in. Watch out, Dexter. It may not be worth it. I'll just let you know, brother. Just watch out. Okay. With that all being said, let's go over the week of the Raw and SmackDown shows. Like I said, I thought SmackDown was solid. What really can't you say about the John Cena and Roman Reigns segment? It was awesome. I'm excited to see what they do with this tomorrow night on SmackDown. And it's going to be a fun night. Roman Reigns and John Cena's box office. Anybody's trying to convince you on social media that Sasha and Bianca need a main event SummerSlam? Just stop. That's cap. As AJ Styles would say. By the way, I got something regarding cap later on. Be on the lookout for that. I want to mention with this, I thought for the most part Raw this week was on autopilot mode, and I expressed this point on the Hoots Podcast before. The concept of what's a good go home show and what isn't is kind of passe in my opinion. I mentioned this with Andrew last week, Andrew Maidala. I tell him, like, I'm just waiting for SummerSlam to get here. And, like, all this extra stuff that we're getting on Raw and SmackDown this week, it's just plot points. It's not the same as it was when I was a teenager or when I was younger, where the go-home show is, like, the biggest thing ever. It's just a different thing. I will say I liked this segment with Goldberg and Lashley at the end. I thought that was good. The Orton and Riddle reuniting on Raw was good as well, but
I feel like Raw is, I felt like it was on autopilot mode. I feel like sometimes with the, my issue with the Raw show is the formatting and just the tone of the show. It's like, I feel like Vince McMahon shuffles through the playlist he listens to every single week, and that's how he comes up with the matches. It's like, okay, here's the matches that we've had this past month. Let's just shuffle around in this variation and continue the stories going on. And that's not good. It's not good. I mean, I thought AJ and Riddle had a good match to start off the show, but there's just a lot of going through the motions on Raw as a whole, and there's just no life to it. I mean, you know, that's as critical as I'm going to get on here. I just feel like there's no life to Raw. You know, as much as I give flack towards AEW stuff, at least they have an energy in the crowd, but this, when it comes to Raw, it's like a bottomless pit sometimes, and I don't want that to be the case, but I want Raw to have some juice back to it, and I don't know what you do with that. And it's so easy to say, oh, don't have the show for 3 hours, but, you know, and it's not to say Raw doesn't have good episodes too. I want to make that perfectly clear, but yeah, I agree with a lot of the sentiments out there that Raw's the worst show that WWE produces each week, but for me, I'm like a solution guy. Okay, tell me one thing, but what are we going to do to fix it? You know what I mean? Okay, Raw sucks. What can we do to fix it? I don't need to be told 100 times throughout a month span that Raw sucks. I know that Raw sucks. You don't need to tell me that. So, let's get that out of the way. Also, I want to give a shout out to Seth Rollins. I thought his promos the last couple weeks heading towards this match with Edge has been fantastic. Edge will be on SmackDown on Friday, tomorrow night, as I'm recording this on a Thursday. And that's going to be pretty dope. So, excited for that. I am kind of bummed that I won't get to watch SmackDown live this week because I'm going to the United Center for the Rampage show. But I am excited to see what they do to get these going. And I'm expecting a bigger segment out of Bianca and Sasha for this week. I know they had a contract signing last week, and then we'll have to see how that goes. But for me, I think Bianca and Sasha will have another good match at SummerSlam, but no, it's not going to be the main event of this show. I'm sorry, folks. It's not going to happen. Okay, with that being said, let's get to some predictions. No, for the slam that happens in the summer. We have 10 matches on this show. We'll start off here. Alexa Bliss and Eva Hori. I'm going to go with Alexa Bliss. I really don't have much to say about this. I mean, anytime either Alexa or Eva Rhea on my screen is a good thing, you know, from a waterfall purpose. But as far as the storyline is concerned and all that extra stuff, I really don't care for it. I'm going to go with Alexa Bliss to win, though. I have the Usos retaining against the Mysterios at SummerSlam. And don't be surprised if Dominic turns on Rey. You could do some injury angle where you get Rey off of television for 5 or 6 months or something and brings back up towards WrestleMania season. Just be on the lookout for that. This is all I'm going to say. What else we got here? This is a really good card, guys, for SummerSlam, guys. You got a really good card of a lot of good matches out here. Let's talk about Drew McIntyre and Jinder Mahal. Shanky and Veer. I'm telling you guys right now, don't be surprised. Either two things. One, either this is a short match with an indecisive finish. And don't forget, there's an Extreme Rules pay-per-view that's coming around the corner from this pay-per-view. I think you're either going to get an indecisive finish, or Jinder's going to find a way to beat Drew McIntyre at SummerSlam. don't be surprised. I'm just throwing it out there right now. So I think they'll have a good match. I don't think it's going to be long, though. I think they're going to find a way to keep this continuing after SummerSlam. So it's kind of like a transitional match on this pay-per-view card, which is fine by me. Let's go to Charlotte Flair against Nikki A.S.H. and Rhea Ripley, the triple threat match for the Raw Women's Championship. I have Nikki A.S.H. retaining over Charlotte and Rhea Ripley. I think for me, it'd be really, really cool if the Hurricane and Molly Holly, who are producers right now for the WWE, if they found a way to bring Nikki out, introduce them to the crowd, and validate her as a superhero. I think that'd be awesome. Be really, really awesome. So I'm going with Nikki A.S.H. to retain, and that's my prediction. No. I love doing that. Shout out to Brent Carter. He came up with the idea. That's fantastic. SummerSlam next match here we'll go over is Damian Priest and Sheamus for the United States Championship. I got Damian Priest becoming your brand new United States Champion. This is going to be a barn burner. This is the type of matches that I enjoy transcribing from a physicality standpoint and this match layout standpoint. Sheamus does not get the respect that he deserves on these type of shows, and he's going to get it from yours truly because that man deserves some respect put on his name, damn it. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to give Sheamus his props, and I think that's proper. That's proper, pal. So let's go with Priest to become the new U.S. champion. I think it's the right choice to go with that, you know. Next year that we got on this spectacular card, we got Randy Orton and Matt Riddle going after AJ Styles and Omos for the Raw Tag Team titles. I think RK-Bro become your new Raw Tag Team champions. This has been building up for the last month and a half or so. So we got Randy back on TV. They had the full reunion on Raw this Monday. I think they bring the titles home on this show. This should be a good match. And I probably find a way where Orton does the RKO out of nowhere on somebody. But somebody's taking a pinfall, and Orton and Riddle are going to become your tag team champions. So that's going to be a good match to watch. Let's see what else we got here. Oh, should we get into it? Yes. Let's talk about Billy Goldberg against Bobby Lashley. I have two scenarios here. I think Bobby Lashley wins via referee stoppage, or I think you can find a way to have good sympathy where you have Bobby Lashley make Goldberg pass out, and you continue to do the Hurt Lock after the match is over. Then Biggie cashes in. If not, and people try to crap on it, and I don't know how long this match is going to be with Bobby Lashley and Goldberg. I don't expect it to be super long. You can still find a way to have Biggie implement himself and become the new WWE champion. So anything can happen. I am kind of curious. The story they told in this match for me has got me interested into it. I'm not going to lie. I get it. People don't want to see Goldberg in title matches in 2021. I completely understand that and respect that opinion. But the story they told for the last couple weeks and these last two promos these guys had with each other has got me interested. And I'm curious to see what goes down on Sunday. But either Bobby Lashley retains via referee stoppage, or Big E pulls off of Seth Rollins and walks out of Allegiant Stadium as your new WWE World Heavyweight Champion. No. Trying to remember what else here we got here in the card. Hopefully I didn't forget anything pertinent here. Let me pull it up here. Great reference site is called Pro Wrestling Transcriptions. .com. It really is the number one reference site for wrestling matches and stuff like that. Got it right over here. Let's go to Bianca Belair and Sasha Banks for the SmackDown Women's Championship. I got Bianca retaining here. It's the right choice. I don't see her losing to Sasha. I just don't. I mean, I won't be surprised if she wins, if Sasha Banks wins, but I think Bianca wins, or like I mentioned earlier, they could have some type of like indecisive finish where it leads to a hardcore match at Extreme Rules. I think people need to remember that if you get some undecisive finishes, that doesn't mean the feuds are ending. It means it's going to happen at Extreme Rules. So be on the lookout for that. I do have Bianca Belair retaining, though, clean. And then the last two, the most important matches, in my opinion, Edge against Seth Rollins. I mentioned earlier, I think Edge is going to beat Seth Rollins. It's going to cause Rollins to get to a point where he's so unhinged, he needs to go to a different brand. And just a good time for Seth Rollins, you got the WWE draft right around the corner. Then we got this show at the MSG, this big show at Madison Square Garden, so be on the lookout for that. I got Edge beating Seth Rollins, but I'm really excited for that match, and it's going to be dope. And finally, and certainly not least, Mr. Jacob Toretto will have to acknowledge the head of the table, our tribal chief, Roman Reigns, is putting down John Cena at SummerSlam. It's going to be an awesome match. It's going to be an awesome atmosphere. I'm really excited for some of these counter transition spots that John Cena has always been good at over the years. There's going to be parts of the match where you feel that Cena might win. You don't know. But if you watched their match in No Mercy from 2017, which is also another great match, and see how much Roman has evolved, not only on the mic, but in the ring over the last 3 or 4 years, this match is going to be awesome. It's going to be an awesome storytelling aspect. I'm excited to see what the match layout is. But in the end, one way or another, the Tribal Chief will remain your WWE Universal Champion. And that's the brass tacks, pal. That's what it is. So I got Roman Reigns retaining over John Cena. But I'm looking at this card, guys, for SummerSlam. It looks really, really good. I think we're in for some really good action. For this pay-per-view, there's things that you can do with or without. Sure, but you can say that about any wrestling show. And I think SummerSlam's going to be a hit this year. Let's get to NXT TakeOver 36. That's happening on Sunday. So I'm going to start off here with LA Knight against Cameron Grimes for the $1 million title. If LA Knight wins, the $1 million man, Ted DiBiase, will become his butler. That's an interesting matchup, to say the least. I'm going to go with Cameron Grimes to become your new $1 million champion. The story comes full circle. Both guys go their separate ways. So I got Cameron Grimes becoming your new $1 million champion. Then we got Dakota Kai against Raquel Gonzalez for the NXT Women's Championship. I told Drew this on Tuesday on SNE Network. I got Dakota Kai becoming your new NXT Women's Champion, and you see Raquel Gonzalez popping up on Raw very soon. Also, on this fine NXT TakeOver card that we got here is Adam Cole against Kyle O'Reilly in a 2-out-of-3 falls match, aka a 3 stages of hell match. The first stipulation is a regular wrestling match. The second one is a street fight. And then the third one, if necessary, is in the confines of a steel cage. fitting conclusion to this rivalry, remember the last 3 stages of hell match that Adam Cole had in a takeover with Giant Gargano. That one took 1.5 hours for me to type out. Good God. I don't know how long this one's going to take me. But yeah, I got Adam Cole taking the L here. His final salute to the NXT brand. Kyle O'Reilly, much to the chagrin to my guy Blake Mitchell Moore, will beat Adam Cole at NXT TakeOver 36. And then finally, the last two matches, Walter against Ilya Dragunov, the Ring General, the best attraction in professional wrestling today. Walter will retain over Ilya Dragunov. This is going to be an awesome match. part of me is going to be bummed out that they won't have the time to tell their match and their story like they did at NXT UK, because that first match went almost 40 minutes. But this one is going to be special. And I sincerely hope that they allow Nigel McGuinness to do color commentary on this match, because he is the best color commentator that WWE has. I love Pat McAfee as much as anybody, but Nigel McGuinness is the best color commentator in the WWE. And he calls the matches on NXT UK, so he should have that opportunity to, you know, to do that. So I'm going to go with Walter to retain over Ilya Dragunov, and then finally Karrion Kross against Samoa Joe for the NXT title. I think it's far foregone conclusion that Samoa Joe's going to win. Their brawl to end NXT this week was kind of crazy, especially that spear through the barricade. That was a nice visual. But yeah, I'm excited to see Joe back in the ring for the first time in almost 18 months, and it's going to be an awesome environment as well. It's talking about big fight feel. And it should be a lot of fun. I'm going to go with Samoa Joe to become your new NXT champion. So, three new champions on a big takeover show with the future of NXT up in the air. I think they have three new title changes and brings in some new buzz and anticipation for their brand coming out of this event on Sunday. So, I'll be having those transcripts for you guys this weekend on ProWrestlingTranscriptions.com. And also, make sure to check out my analyst thoughts on it on the SME network as well. So, it should be a fun weekend of wrestling shows to transcribe. Speaking of transcriptions, I got NXT UK today. We always do a little preview for NXT UK because we dropped this on early Thursday afternoon. We got two title matches. First off, Miko Satomura against Stevie Turner for the NXT UK Women's Championship. And then Mustache Mountain is taking on Pretty Deadly for the NXT Tag Team titles. That's going to be a long match. That's going to be a long show to type out. But it should be a good match to type out nonetheless. Yeah, so ladies and gentlemen, that's what happened this week in WWE. All right, folks. Time to get the people what they want, what they've been waiting for. The main event of the evening. It is time for What the Hell is Wrong with AEW. We got a new twist added to the segment this week. Be on the lookout for it. But as per usual, we're going to start off with Bret Carter in a 3-2-1.
It's time for What the Hell is Wrong with AEW. What the hell is wrong with AEW? You know, every week I ask myself, self, is there anything that AEW could do to make their product worse? It's gotten pretty low in the toilet. There's no way it could possibly get worse. And then I am amazed at this godforsaken imitation piss-ass poor wrestling company and their ability to outdo themselves with the complete and utter dog trash that they continue to put out week after week. This was one of the worst episodes of Dynamite that they've put on, and yet they expect us to believe that this sports-based wrestling program is a legitimate threat to anybody involved in the professional wrestling business. And I'm going to say, and I want to say more about that later, about if this company continues the quote-unquote momentum they have, the wrestling business is essentially dead. This is going to be the end of the wrestling business if AEW continues to have this quote-unquote success that they do and this following that they do. Because if this is the case, the wrestling business will officially be over in the next 5 years and we'll all be out of a job. But let's get into it. All right, I didn't have a chance to watch Rampage this week, but I'll just say a couple things about the results. So, AEW debuts a new show for their company, and they start their very first match featuring an Impact World Championship. Unbelievable that you can't even promote your own product on a brand new wrestling program. Man, that's genius right there, Tony Khan. Fuego do Sol, who I believe is like 1-40 or whatever, earns a contract after getting squashed by Miro. That's genius. And then we have the debut of Jamie Hayter, who the crowd didn't even know who this person was. Like, they, again, AEW just predicates themselves on being based off all of these internet marks who knows who every single one of these performers is. But, you know, Jamie Hayter comes out and nobody has any clue who she is. Like, how did that make sense at all to close your debut show? We have, you know, you close your opening show with this person that nobody knows who it is. Booker of the year right there, pal. Give me a freaking break. Okay, let's get into Dynamite. I have about 2 pages of notes of crap that I wrote about how horrendously terrible this program was. Okay, the show starts with Moxley and Kingston come out. Okay, fine, we're going to quote-unquote hear from them. But then they get jumped by 2.0 Daniel Garcia. Like, but then Sting and Darby Allin come out. And then we go right into this Texas Tornado match, which is essentially more garbage deathmatch wrestling. It's essentially just a brawl between 5 folks. And then Kingston and Moxley get involved. And it's just, you know, and they're going on the concourse. And I thought this was a tag match. This match was stupid, and it was a stupid way to start the show. Sting looked okay, I guess. His spot where he went through the table and then jumped right up was kind of cool, I guess. But other than that, this was stupid and a very convoluted and confusing way to open up this program. But it all went south from here. Of course, AEW is not capable of having a match without starting or having some sort of brawl or, you know, some sort of outside war, either before a match or during a match or whatever. And the referees have no authority to cause a disqualification. I don't think there's been one disqualification in the history of AEW. Are there no disqualifications? Is that, like, part of the deal in this professional wrestling company? All right. So we get Sammy Guevara and Sean Spears. I will say that Sammy Guevara proposing is cool. Congratulations to Sammy Guevara and Pam. You know, that's always a very cool thing when two people realize they want to spend the rest of their lives together. So that's pretty cool. Congratulations to Sammy and Pam for that. That was neat. We get this match and it was fine. But then, of course, Sean Spears blades and cuts himself really deep because you can't have an AEW match without blood either. And so that happens, and there's blood everywhere, and I don't know if he got busted open the hard way, but the announcers were really confused, but that doesn't really seem to make a difference because the announcers have no idea what the hell is going on at any time. They don't know where we're going. They can't cut a camera angle. They can't have a flow of a show. They're horrible. So this was fine, I guess. I just don't understand why you need a brawl all the time. God, I hate Don Callis, or should I say Don Fallis. I mean, that his promos, his voice, everything about Don Callis makes me just want to throw my remote at the television screen and change the channel or mute it or whatever. If it wasn't for this segment, I would turn off All Elite Wrestling. There is nothing elite about All Elite Wrestling, especially the Elite. And we'll get into that in just a second. But anytime Don Callis opens his mouth, I want to vomit and throw up. I can't stand Don Callis. Okay, so I'm sure there's going to be some mixed bags about this American top team dude. I have no idea who this is. I don't know why I should care. The only thing I'll say about that promo is that I will say about what he's saying about AEW is spot on. It's not an answer to pro wrestling. But then we get this really stupid angle for some reason between Scorpio Sky, Ethan Page, and Lance Archer. So you've got this Murder Hawk monster. Again, Booker of the Year, pal. You got this Murder Hawk monster who's a legitimate threat. You know, he's got a good look. He's good in the ring. And they're wasting away in this stupid, you know, he was out there for 30 seconds to get beat down by Ethan Page and Scorpio Sky. Where's the consistency in your booking? Where's the consistency in your storylines? Oh, wait, AEW doesn't have any because all they care about is flips and spots and spot monkeys and putting, you know, and the EVPs, the Elite, putting themselves over. That's all this freaking company is based upon. Okay. Let's get into it. The next thing we get is the Elite versus Lucha, Jungle Express. Seriously, fuck the Elite. They are the most annoying, overhyped, ridiculous faction of all time. They suck. How they have managed to blind Tony Khan, who I guess is as stupid as he looks, this friggin' billionaire, to think that they are over. Nick and Matt Jackson, I are an embarrassment to the professional wrestling industry. Nick and Matt Jackson are an embarrassment to the professional wrestling industry. And then you add Kenny Omega, who is the most overhyped champion of all time, Don Callis, who has the most annoying voice I've ever heard, and then you have the stupid-ass Brandon Cutler, stupid-ass Michael Naka 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 Go the Fuck Home, the Good Brothers, who are no longer good, and you have the worst faction of all time. They are horrible in every way, shape, or form, and if their momentum continues to get forward, professional wrestling will be dead, because if people leave WWE to watch this crap and then realize this is what they got there and they decide not to go back to WWE, the wrestling business will be dead in 5 years because of this, if the quote-unquote success of this piss-poor wrestling company. Seriously, is there any match in AEW that doesn't involve an outside brawl of some sort, right? Omega and Cage brawl during outside their match for some reason. Also, why does the referee not call for a disqualification with outside interference? Like, what are these officials doing? This is complete and utter dog trash. The Elite is the worst faction of all time. Period. The end. And now we're going to get Paul White versus QT Marshall for some reason. I will say, Paul White can still deliver a promo. That was good. But QT Marshall is a complete tool. And that was, and he, you know, I can't stand him or the factory. All right, so we're going to see Paul White throw a knockout punch to QT Marshall at All Out. The crowd will pop, and then that's all that will happen with that. Somewhere in there was a promo with Jamie Hayter. I will say that promo was cool, along with DMD. They are both terrific. And I will say that Britt Baker is currently the face of AEW over MJF, and we'll get into that here in a little bit. But good promo from Jamie Hayter, even though I have no idea who the hell she is. But she can cut a promo, so that was very cool. Then for some reason, we're going to... hold on. Let's see. Well, I'll say this now because I can't remember where it was on the thing. So I guess Jade Cargill is going to be wrestling. We haven't seen her in the ring for a long time. I hope she can still go. I'm kind of tired of her vignettes. I want to see what she can actually do in the ring, because we haven't seen her in the ring in like 3 months. So I don't know if she can actually still go, but we'll see. All right, what the hell was that promo from Taz? So he comes out, he tries to put himself over. He introduces Ricky Starks. Ricky Starks, they have a cut to the back with Brian Cage and Powerhouse Hobbs. Then all of a sudden, Cage gets up, and then the two of them start to brawl, and then they cut, and then Ricky Starks runs away. And it was a generic waste of about 4 minutes on my television program, or on my television. Like, there's no flow to this at all. And then all of a sudden, we randomly go to the back. After that brief tag segment, we automatically quickly cut to a promo with the Death Triangle. Like, where is the pace and the flow of this show? They don't have it. These morons don't know how to run a television program. It's embarrassing. It's insulting. It's horrible. Then, okay, we get an okay match with Penelope Ford and Thunder Rosa, but it seems like everybody is using a cutter now. I think I saw like 6 different wrestlers use a cutter as one of their moves, which is fine. It's a cool move, but can we be a little bit more individualized, and can we be a little bit more creative with your talent? Okay, and then we get to the main event. Chris Jericho against MJF. You know, you would think that after 4 weeks of going through quote-unquote hell, Jericho would be a little bit more pissed off going to his match with MJF. He was smiling. He was happy. Now, I will say the crowd singing Judas without music was pretty darn cool. Like, that was the fact that they could all do it. That was a really neat moment, and it proves that Judas is the anthem of AEW, and I have no problems with that. That's really cool. And so I thought that was a really neat and special moment for the fans. I've said for a long time, I think the Judas thing is really cool. I have no problems with that. I think that's awesome. However, you would think that Jericho would be more willing and intensely and really willing to just beat the crap out of MJF. He was smiling, whatever. He moved so slow. He treated this with no urgency at all. He doesn't really seem like he cares about this feuds anymore. And this match was just terrible. And it's the quote-unquote culmination of this lengthy feud. Are you kidding me? Chris Jericho has to give it up. He doesn't have it anymore. And honestly, MJF didn't look that great in the ring either. He oversold too. This is why Britt Baker is the new face of AEW, not MJF. MJF, I said if they used MJF correctly, he could have perhaps one of the greatest careers in the history of professional wrestling. But if MJF has any chance of salvaging his career, he has to get out of AEW because AEW is ruining him. And you could just see it with this match last night. So Chris Jericho loses, which is, of course, is no surprise there. We all knew this was going to happen. So the referee's back was turned. Chris Jericho uses his bat, but decides not to use the Judas effect while the ref is not looking. How does that make sense? You can finish your opponent off with the ref not looking, get the upper hand on MJF, but instead he taps out. I mean, we're probably going to get one more match between them at All Out with, like, and this will be the culmination of the feud with, like, if Jericho loses, he'll be done wrestling forever. Though I think that really should be the stipulation, and MJF should win because Chris Jericho needs to give it up. He doesn't have it anymore. He's slow. He's fat. He's boring and uninteresting to watch. And Chris Jericho just has to give it up. So this was the main event of this wrestling program that was absolute shit from the beginning to the end. AEW should be embarrassed. Tony Khan should be embarrassed that he's essentially the Young Bucks say they're killing the business, and they're right. The wrestling business will be over in 5 years if All Elite Wrestling continues to have the momentum that they have and these uneducated nobodies who have no clue how to run a wrestling promotion continue to put themselves over and pay themselves a lot of money to put this crap out on television. The wrestling business will be done in 5 years if this shit is allowed to continue. Seriously, what the fuck is wrong with AEW?
This has been What the Hell is Wrong with AEW.
Thank you, Brother Carter, for the submission this week, my man. Oh, yes. What the hell is wrong with AEW? Again, what isn't wrong with AEW? Before I get into the shenanigans that was, I don't know what the hell you call last night's show at the Fertitta Center, aka Trump territory. We have a new element that we're introducing here at the Hoots podcast, and I want to go over it with you guys. And it's a shout out to our guy Mike at Main Events for a guy we got to meet and a good brother of the podcast. We got to meet him in New Orleans at WrestleMania 34, which is really cool. And it was a fun time getting to meet him down there and stuff. That was awesome. Now, here's the thing. We like to evolve what the hell is wrong with AEW if we're going to continue doing this segment each week. I don't want it to get to the point where it's stale and we're doing the same stuff over and over again. So I want, during the time as we continue on with this podcast and this segment, I want us to evolve the bit, basically. And we want your interaction with it. I feel like this segment of out of anything we do besides the Q&A is probably one of the most interactive segments that we have in wrestling podcasting today. Your guys' feedback and support of this segment has meant a lot to me and Brother Carter. And those who really get the gist of this bit, we do really, really appreciate you guys. We really do. So, with that being said, we're introducing a new element in the coming weeks called A Trip Down Capville. Now, for those who don't know what cap means basically that you're lying. And the gist of this is basically, you know how celebrities read mean tweets on the Jimmy Kimmel Show? Well, I'm asking the listeners of this podcast to send me stupid tweets that you see from wrestling Twitter. And I'm going to go over them on this podcast and I'll decide whether I agree with it or it's cap, basically. So it's called A Trip Down Capville. And I think it's very good for this particular segment because there's a lot of hyperbole that comes out of people in the wrestling media when it comes to AEW. And I get it, they're the new company, so a lot of those people in the media want to get passes and act like they do nothing wrong. And AEW's Teflon. But here in the Hoots podcast, especially for a wrestling company that claims to be elite, we leave no stone unturned on this podcast. No company is off limits. And we call a spade here on the Hoots podcast. So a trip down Capville is what we're introducing here on the podcast. And there's a little demo part of it that I'm going to get to right now before I get my thoughts on Dynamite this week. And I want to thank Mike for sending me this because this may be the stupidest thing I've read this entire year. And I know a couple weeks ago we went over the Nimrod that was going after Brother Carter the other day. A couple weeks ago for his article that he wrote on WrestlingRumors.net, right? And I read that one and saying that, you know, AEW is tapping into the pulse and the roots of wrestling. Yeah, all right. Keep telling yourself that, pal. So, I'll scroll down here in my notifications on Twitter because Mike sent this to me on here. We got it right here. So, here we go. I'm sure you've seen this post circulating on Twitter over the last couple days. I'm not going to give the handle of this person because I'm not going to do that. But it says, when you have modern day versions of the following. Here's this roll call that he has here, okay? Go figure that his name is Mark, right? MJF. Now, for those who are listening to this and they're driving, please pay attention to the road. I don't want you to start laughing where you start losing focus. And those who are drinking coffee or depending on the time of the day you're listening to this segment in this podcast, I'm proceeding you with caution just in case you have a spit take or anything like that, okay? Here we go. Now, these are not my comparisons. This is our Mark friend here that wanted to make a name out of himself. So, here we go. MJF equals The Rock. Jon Moxley equals Stone Cold Steve Austin. Mickey Rourke equals Hulk Hogan. Pockets equals Triple H. Kenny Olivier equals Bret Hart and Ric Flair. Not one person, but two. Hangman on the press page, John Cena and HBK. Darby Allin, Undertaker, Phoenix, Mysterio, Pieface Buck, and Baldy Buck, the Hardy Boys. When you have this kind of star power in 2020, RAEW, remember, he says RAEW, always gonna outdraw WWE. Hope dumb WWE fans get it. Oh my god. It's one thing to say that MJF's The Rock, because that's just grade A homogenized Holstein bullshit, but Pockets and Triple H? What? Okay. I could get his point maybe about Jericho being the Hulk Hogan of NWO and WCW and stuff like that. I could see that maybe. But even then, you're going to tell me that the fucking dinner circle compares to the NWO? Get the fuck out of here. Kenny Olivier equals Bret Hart? Why? Because he's Canadian? Freaking Bret Hart would wrestle circles around Olivier. Kenny Omega and Ric Flair. Get the fuck out of here. How about this? Hangman Page is the equivalent of John Cena and Shawn Michaels. Okay, maybe you want to say the Shawn Michaels thing because they got the hair and stuff like that. Like, come on, man. This one pissed me off. And look, I love Darby Allin. Darby Allin's one of my favorite wrestlers that AEW has. But you're telling me that he's on the same level as The Undertaker? Like, it's not even to say this is cap. This is just grade A bullshit. What is this? MJF equals The Rock. Orange Cassidy equals Triple H. Guys, please. Somebody line me up for some IQ test with a therapist sooner or later, because I'm going to need it after recording these segments, man. Oh my god. What kind of bullshit is that? Of course, the go-to is the Young Bucks and Hardy Boys. No shit. No shit. But Omega, Bret Hart, get out of here. And no, John Moxley is not Stone Cold Steve Austin. Just stop. Oh my god. Literally, it's Cap. All this is Cap. And we're going to get more into this as this segment continues to evolve. A trip down Capville, but that's just a little demo of it right there. My god. Orange Cassidy and Triple H. Oh, Lord. Okay. Well, this show started off last night with Sting and Darby Allin against 2.0. I still don't get the pairing of Garcia and 2.0. I don't get that, but whatever. Garcia attacked Jon Moxley. They're going to have their match at Rampage in the main event tomorrow. I'm happy for the Everard guys, 2.0. I like their group. I like the tag team. I don't know why NXT got rid of them, but I like their group. But the spot at the end with the double powerbomb through the table was stupid. Not that they did it, but the fact that Sting got up like nothing. And now you want to say, okay, you want to show to the fans that he's not injured, maybe people thinking too much about the whole Seth Rollins spot. Okay, I can see your talking point of that, but still, this is the whole company that wants to get back to the roots of professional wrestling. That's what I was told, right? And yet, no selling on this show. Not only this match, the Sean Spears Sammy Guevara match. What the hell was that? And why did it take fucking Aubrey Edwards 3 minutes to eject Tully Blanchard from ringside? Why didn't you eject him from ringside before you rang the damn bell? Before you started the damn match? Now, Sammy and Sean Spears had a decent match, but I thought this match overstayed its welcome. And, you know, again, Sean Spears is not a bad wrestler or anything like that. But honestly, does anybody have enough emotional investment for you to get into a fucking 18-minute match with him and Sammy Guevara? I mean, I'm asking you. I'm not talking about the AEW sheep that are going to drool and chant this is awesome for every little thing that they put on their TV shows. Hell, they would say this is awesome for Ryzen and Fuego del Sol. Like, give me a break. I'm not talking about those people. I don't get it. I really don't. This was a stupid part of the show for me. One of the things I did like from AEW this week was the Dan Lambert promo. Talk about heat, man. That guy is a heat magnet. You can tell on the grin on his face that he was eating up the fact that the crowd started to boo him. Going back to the other stuff of the show, this is a really bad formatting episode of the show. I thought the transitions from the announcers this week was really, really bad. A lot of backstage segments of hints, but nothing consequential or worthwhile of note, you know? We know that Pac is fighting Andrade, but they already mentioned that last week. What other incentive do you have to watch All Out now? Oh, okay. CM Punk is going to show up. Okay, that's the draw. That's the hook in line for All Out, I guess. You know? I don't have incentive to watch your show because, one, Kenny Omega and Christian Cage is not a main event pay-per-view match in my eyes. Whatever else they're going to announce in this card, they're waiting last minute for. You know, it's funny. People will be like, oh, you know, there's a pay-per-view coming up for WWE, but why did it take so long to announce the full card? But, oh, it's okay for AEW because it's long-term storytelling. It's long-term booking. You got to understand how it goes. They do it right. They map things out. You know, Tony Khan is really good when it comes to spacing and letting things balance and letting things breathe with feuds and storylines. Oh, there's concrete booking and some of these odd buzzwords that I hear on some of these podcasts. Some of it's amazing to me. But, like, we're about 2.5 weeks out away from All Out, right? And we've got, like, what, 2 or 3 matches announced? at best. Like, what's the women's title match? I'm not going to get to it. We'll get to that next week. Here we go. We had the Cucamonga Kids against the Jurassic Express for the AEW World Tag Team titles. By the way, why don't they just call AEW's Tag Team Division the Tornado Tag Team Division? This is a revelation to me. They don't even have freaking tag ropes by the turnbuckles. So I shouldn't be surprised that every tag match that AEW does turns into a clusterfuck and makes the referees look stupid. So let's go down the roll call here of who we had out here. So we had Don Fallis on commentary, right? In the match, we have Balding Buck, Pieface Buck, alongside the Goof Brothers, Cutlet, and Michael Knock It the Fuck Off and Go the Fuck Home and Stay the Fuck Home. Then on the Jurassic Express side, we have Dino Douche, Stunted Growth, and here's the new one, ladies and gentlemen, Red Box Value Tarzan. There you go. Red Box Value Tarzan. Type that out and put hashtag the Hoots Podcast every time you see Jungle Boy come on your screen. Oh my God. This match was grade A horseshit. The match layout was absolutely ridiculous. Every Young Bucks match continues to be the same in lower quality as the weeks go by. I don't care how many moves and stuff you do in the match. That doesn't constitute it being a good match. What the hell is the story of this match? Besides the parts where they're spraying each other with cool spray, whatever the hell that is. And all this interference with the Goof Brothers and Cutlet and Knock It the Fuck Off. And it's like, and then they got this announcement later on the show that we're going to have this AEW World Tag Team Eliminator qualifying tournament. And the winner of that match will fight the Young Bucks in a steel cage and All Out, as if that's going to change anything when it comes to interference. Like, who are you fooling here? And then, by the way, this goes back to the double standard crowd out there. Those that give AEW a pass and everything that they do, right? So, riddle me this, Sherlock. You're going to tell me that you have an issue when WWE does these championship contender matches, but no comment when it comes to title eliminator. Like, don't you notice the double standards that continue to happen between both these shows? Or am I the only one that's going to be able to point this out because I'm not watching a wrestling show with a fucking agenda? I see what I see and I deserve what I deserve. Should be that hard of a concept to do in 2021. But hey, that's the wrestling media for you. Then next, we got into Paul White coming out. He's going to fight QT Marshall at All Out. Fine. I'm not going to come on here and railroad on it. I will say that this segment went way too fucking long. Big Show's fighting QT Marshall. Whoopity-doo. Like, I'm not going to come here and trash it. If Big Show wants to wrestle, that's awesome. I thought he sounded fine with this promo. This is not pay-per-view worthy. A rematch with Kenny Olivier, Christy Cage, and Big Show and QT Marshall is not a hook for me. So I'm not gonna lose sleep over it. I really not. It is what it is. And then, like Brett Carter mentioned with the stuff with Team Taz, I don't know what the fuck that was. Does anybody really want to see a Brian Cage and Ricky Starks rematch? I don't. What else? Here on a positive tip, I thought Thunder Rosa and Penelope Ford had another good match. Shocker. It's interesting when AEW allows the woman to have some spotlight on TV and not just try to drop in any WWE release talent and give them 15 minutes of airtime every single week. This match was really good. I say it every week that Penelope is really good. She's really, really good at what she does. I don't think she gets her props for what she does in the ring. And you know what? I think for her, she's above being on the YouTube shows that they bury her on all the time. Like, she's good. during the title scene, you can't just make the whole division just about Britt Baker. I love her. Everybody loves Britt Baker. She's great. DMD. I'm all in with that. But you got other talented women in this division that could be top heels as well, besides just Britt Baker. And, you know, Vicky Guerrero coming out trying to convince everybody that, oh, Nyla Rose is a big threat for the AEW Women's Title Match after every time Nyla Rose loses an AEW Women's World Title Match. It's not convincing to me. I don't buy into the shtick. I don't. Like, Nyla Rose, as far as intimidation factor, that's completely gone. Like, I don't buy what they're selling with that anymore. And then we had an announcement of Pockets getting into a program with the Running Limp Man, Matt Hardy. No interest in that. Let's look at the cards, by the way, for Dynamite next week and Rampage on Friday. So you have Malakai Black against Brock Anderson, Red Velvet against Jamie Hayter. You have the Varsity Blondes and the Lucha Brothers. And then, like I just mentioned, Matt Hardy against Orange Cassidy. That's Dynamite next week in Milwaukee, by the way. Then on Rampage, we got Private Party, a team that's completely regressed and fall off the means since joining the Hardy family office, against the Jurassic Express. So I have to see Dino Douche wrestle in person. That's going to be an interesting experience. And then we have Jade Cargill against Kiera Hogan. I am looking forward to that. And then the main event is Jon Moxley and Daniel Garcia. I read off those two cards. Do those cards ring elite to you? Does that entice you to want to watch those shows? Oofa. And then finally, we had Chris Jericho against MJF. I don't understand why this was not added to All Out. If this was the whole part of the Five Labors of Jericho, why would you just do a clean submission finish on television? What, we're going to have MJF gloat about it, then Eric Bischoff comes out and finds a loophole to get Jericho's rematch at All Out? Is that what we're going to do here? Now, don't get wrong, I thought the match was fine. It was decent. You know, this is probably Jericho's best performance in the Five Labors of Jericho, given all the crap that he was doing beforehand. MJF winning was not, I didn't have an issue with that because I thought that was the right person to win in all this. For me, I just would have switched it up with the fact that the fifth match should have happened and ended at the pay-per-view. Now they're going to find some loophole 2 weeks in before the pay-per-view. What? We're going to bring Eric Bischoff in full circle with all this stuff, the town hall meeting, the debates, the war council, whatever talking said that they did on Dynamite over the past couple months and so when these guys started to feud with each other. And it's like, no, I don't want to see Chris Jericho and MJF again. I don't. You decided to do it on television. Let that be. Send Jericho on his way. He needs time off of television. And I have no other interest in seeing him on there anymore. At least for a while. He doesn't have to go away for good. But I just don't understand that. You should have just had that match on the pay-per-view. Now we got 2 weeks from All Out in. You tell me that we're not going to see this match again at the pay-per-view? Like, I don't get that. I don't. On that note, that is a wrap for What the Hell is Wrong with AEW this week. A show that I was just mostly indifferent on, you know? The whole stuff, the AEW World Tag Team Time Match was so ridiculous to me. And the commentary does it no favors. I just think that it's funny that AEW tells that they have the greatest tag team division in wrestling, yet their tag team matches are complete and utter horseshit majority of the time. So, all that being said, I am excited to attend my first AEW show tomorrow night at Rampage, and we'll see what goes down at the Madhouse of Madison. That is What the Hell is Wrong with AEW this week. All right, folks, make sure to like the podcast on YouTube, like the video, hit the subscribe button. By the way, if you also can do us a favor, hit that bell button. It notifies you anytime we go live for the Hoops podcast or when a new video gets uploaded to our channel. Make sure to subscribe to the podcast on Apple Podcasts, aka iTunes, Spotify, Google Play, iHeartRadio, anywhere you get your podcast from. Leave us a 4- or 5-star rating and review. It helps expand the reach of the show. Also, you can check out my work at the S&D Network. I'll be doing post-show reviews on Takeover and SummerSlam this weekend, so that should be a lot of fun. And then bookmark ProWrestlingTranscriptions.com as well, so you see my transcripts for those shows as well. And that's pretty much it. You can follow me on Twitter, by the way, if you want, at Josh Lopez Media. And you can follow me on Instagram at Joshie Lopez 94. That's Joshie Lopez 94 on Instagram. And lastly, certainly not least, remember, folks, be the authentic product that is yourself. And remember, nobody dictates the pace of your life but yourself. I love you guys. I hope you enjoy SummerSlam and Takeover and the first dance at the United Center. It's going to be a fun weekend of professional wrestling and all for you wonderful people out there. This has been episode 271 of the Hoots Podcast. We'll recap all this craziness next week on the podcast. With that being said, enjoy the weekend. I love you guys. Now sending off to Brett Carter for this week's edition of the Thoughts of Dericho. Yes, sir.
And now, the Thoughts of Dericho. Listen well, man. Welcome, welcome, one and all, to the biggest podcasting party segment of the summer. It is the Thoughts of Dericho featuring the one, the only, Brother Carter. We're going to keep it short and sweet, well, as short and sweet as one can, with my segment this week simply being my predictions. No! For both NXT TakeOver 36 and SummerSlam occurring this weekend. Big weekend of wrestling action. We have Rampage, anticipated Rampage on Friday. We've got SummerSlam on Saturday, and we have NXT TakeOver 36 on Sunday. So I'm just going to go over my predictions for both TakeOver and SummerSlam. I'm recording this on a Tuesday evening, believe it or not. My work schedule has just been nuts this week. I actually haven't had a chance to watch much wrestling this week. I've got a real, real, real busy schedule this week as I ease back into things for the year. But this is based on a few things that I've seen over the last few weeks and some catching up I've done on some various clips and stuff like that. So these are my predictions. I'm recording this on a Tuesday evening, and the podcast obviously is launching on the Thursday. So these are the matches as of the Tuesday before the show. But we will get in right into those, and we'll go from there. I'm actually going to start with TakeOver first. I know TakeOver is on Sunday, and it's the last show of the weekend. But SummerSlam is the biggest party of the summer. It's the number two show. It's going to give us the most anticipated match of the weekend, I think, of course, with what I believe will be the main event in Cena versus Reigns. But we'll get to that in just a minute. So we're going to start with the NXT TakeOver 36 predictions. No! And as of now, there are 5 matches on the card, which is typical for a TakeOver. There's usually 5 matches on the card. And we got some great stuff coming up this weekend. I'm very much looking forward to the show. It's going to be terrific. And we're going to start with the $1 million championship, LA Knight versus Cameron Grimes. This has been a hilariously, wonderfully entertaining feud ever since LA Knight became the $1 million champion. The stipulation here, of course, is that if LA Knight beats Cameron Grimes, Ted DiBiase becomes the butler of LA Knight. This one's tough. I'm going to take LA Knight here. I think that he's got some good momentum, and you can get a little bit more out of this feud with Cameron Grimes. They can have one more match, and they can put a career on the line. He'll try to save Ted DiBiase or something like that. You know, LA Knight will pull some stunts or whatever to get over or to cheat to win the match. So I'm going to take LA Knight to retain the $1 million championship and Ted DiBiase to become the butler for Mr. Knight. Kyle O'Reilly versus Adam Cole in a 2 out of 3 falls match. I'm going back and forth on this one. Obviously, the news of Bobby Fish being released kind of, I don't know if it throws a monkey wrench into this, but I mean, obviously there's no more Undisputed Era. I'm going to take Kyle O'Reilly here, and I think this sends Adam Cole up to either Raw or SmackDown. You know, I really think WWE is going to do everything they can to keep Adam Cole
Obviously, he's got many ties to AEW, and that's a big rumor with that. I think that would be horrible for his career because AEW is oversaturated with talent anyway, and they don't know what to do with the talent that they have. So, and I know Britt Baker is over there in AEW, so I really think that would be a horrible thing for Adam Cole to do, to sign with that, you know, second-rate, godforsaken, horribly booked company. But nevertheless, I think that they're going to give Kyle O'Reilly the win here, send Adam Cole to either Raw or SmackDown, and then where he will compete for championships. I'm hoping an Intercontinental Championship or a United States Championship feud right away, and we'll get into that here in just a little bit. NXT Women's Championship match, Raquel Gonzalez versus Dakota Kai. I love what Dakota Kai has been doing recently. I think she's great. I don't think it's time to put the belt on her yet. I'm going to take Raquel Gonzalez here to retain her championship, unless they're planning to send her up to either Raw or SmackDown, but I don't think so. I think there's enough star power on Raw and SmackDown right now. We don't need it yet. Raquel can continue to develop and continue to carry the NXT women's brand, which if it was me, I'd be like, why would you want to leave NXT? Because the women's division in NXT is the best in the business right now. So I don't know why you'd want to leave. So, and again, it's probably not her choice. It's WWE management, obviously, but I'm going to take Raquel to retain her. I don't think it's time to take the title off of her yet, but that's going to be a great match. Speaking of great matches, we get to see the second iteration of Walter versus Ilya Dragunov for the NXT UK Championship. Many are saying this has been the match of the year so far when it happened earlier this year. It was absolutely tremendous. I can't wait to see it again on American soil. And I do believe that we will have a new NXT champion, the NXT UK champion, and Ilya Dragunov will finally be able to stop Walter's 2-year reign as NXT UK champion. I'm taking a new champion in Ilya Dragunov to get some more eyes on the NXT UK brand, and what a moment that is going to be. And then finally, the main event, Karrion Kross defending the title against Samoa Joe. Now, I think, and Josh has mentioned this before, I think that Dragunov and Walter should close the show. I understand why it's not, but I think that that match is going to be spectacular, and I think that should close the show. However, Karrion Kross defending the title against Samoa Joe. I go back and forth on this one, too, but I'm going to take Joe because I think they're going to try to push more of Karrion Kross on Raw and hopefully bring Scarlett up after this. So I'm going to take Joe to once again be NXT champion in what's going to be an amazing match to cap off what is going to be an amazing, amazing night of wrestling action. SummerSlam 2021. What a card this is. As of right now, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. There are 10 matches on the card as of now. I'm guessing this will be a 4-hour show. I said that, and that may or may not include the pre-show. It could be a 5-hour show if you include the pre-show. SummerSlam is typically second biggest pay-per-view of the year. Reports are going out that they're trying to treat this as a WrestleMania. Because it's the first, Money in the Bank was cool, and that was great. That was the first pay-per-view back. This is, you know, one of the first, quote-unquote, major of the top two pay-per-views back, and obviously this card is stacked. So let's get right into it. We're starting with the Raw Tag Team Championships, AJ Styles and Omos versus RK-Bro. There's been some tension within RK-Bro over the last couple weeks. They seem to have got things worked out on Raw, and I'm going to take RK-Bro to be your new Raw Tag Team Champions. The chemistry between them is great. I know a lot of people can't stand Riddle. I think he's hilarious. I love me some Matt Riddle. I think he's going to be world champion within 2 years. But I'm taking RK-Bro to be your new Raw Tag Team Champions. Alexa Bliss versus Eva Marie. I go back and forth in this one, too.
Sorry.
I'm hoping... it's funny. Every time, I don't know if you heard that, every time I say Miss Bliss's first name, my smart speaker tends to go off, and, you know, I keep forgetting I have it. But anyways, I go back and forth on this one, too, and I'm going to take Miss Bliss to defeat Eva Marie, and we'll finally see the split between her and Doudrop, and Piper Niven can start doing her thing because she's fantastic. So we'll see. But I am taking Miss Bliss to defeat Eva Marie with potentially the help of Lily. Who knows? Drew McIntyre versus Jinder Mahal in a grudge match. We saw this a couple weeks ago on Raw. We're going to see this again now. I'm going to take Drew McIntyre here. I don't see a reason for him to lose to Jinder Mahal. So, and then I don't know what they do with them after getting into the fall. We will see. But I'm going to take Drew McIntyre to defeat Jinder Mahal in what should be a great match. Speaking of great matches, United States champion Sheamus defending his title against Damian Priest. I said earlier this year, after WrestleMania, that Damian Priest would win the United States Championship at SummerSlam, and I'm sticking by that. Damian Priest is my current favorite superstar on Raw. I think he's absolutely tremendous, and I cannot wait for him to finally get his first singles title run on Raw with the U.S. title. Talk about future world champion. Damian Priest has the it factor, and he will be a world champion sooner before or later. But he's going to start with the U.S. title, and he's going to win it against Sheamus on Saturday. Edge versus Seth Rollins in a battle of the hair. This is going to be terrific. Edge looks fantastic. We know how good Seth Rollins is. I'm going to take Seth Rollins to get the win here, and I think that Rollins, and we're going to get something between Rollins and another former member of the Shield going forward, and we'll talk about that here in just a moment. But I feel getting into the fall, we're going to be able to get that. So I'm taking Seth Rollins to defeat Edge in what could a match that could potentially steal the show. Round two of Bianca Belair versus Sasha Banks for the SmackDown Women's Championship. I like Sasha Banks. I think that she's a very talented person. I think she's great. She is not on the level of Bianca Belair. She's not on the level of Charlotte Flair. In that aspect, she's overrated. And, you know, people just jump to defend her, and I don't get it. Because she's good. Don't get me wrong. I love Sasha Banks. I'd even say she's great, terrific. Like, I really like Sasha Banks. But Bianca Belair is going to win this because Bianca Belair has been outshining Sasha Banks in every way, shape, or form since her return. So, I am taking the EST of WWE to retain her championship against the Boss. SmackDown Tag Team Championships, the Usos versus Rey and Dominic Mysterio. I think this is the time where we see the breakup of the Mysterio family. I like the Usos retaining here. And Dominic eventually turning on his dad, and we'll get a match between them a little bit later on. That crowd reaction when Dominic returns is going to be great. So, really looking forward to that. Bobby Lashley defending the WWE Championship against Goldberg. The longer this match goes, the worse it will be for Goldberg. I think Lashley needs to win this in about 2 minutes. You know, give Goldberg the opportunity to compete for in front of his son again, and that's great. Lashley needs to win this in about 2 minutes and just completely show his dominance going into the fall. And then you can start to set up something with McIntyre. If you want to do something with maybe with Sheamus, depending on what happens with Damian Priest. If Sheamus ends up winning and you want to do that, if you want to do... Or, I mean, there's a number... AJ Styles, there's a number of ways you could go. Actually, I kind of like the idea of AJ Styles if RK-Bro wins the Raw Tag Team titles. Lashley has to win this in under 3 minutes. Otherwise, it's not going to be good for Goldberg. So, Lashley retains, and I hope it's in under 3 minutes. Raw Women's Champion, Nikki A.S.H. versus Rhea Ripley versus Charlotte Flair. I love what Nikki A.S.H. is doing. She's making the most out of her championship. I think she's going to retain here. And I think this is a safe place to have her retain because you can have a funky finish with either Rhea and Charlotte. And it's going to be great. I just hope we start to get some new competition because it's been and don't get me wrong, I love Rhea and Charlotte. They're two of my top five in the world. But I want to see Nikki with some new feuds going into the fall. But that's something potentially with Shayna Baszler. I'm hope you know Shayna Baszler maybe or you know however they want to do it. But I'm hoping it'll be Shayna Baszler, but or Asuka. I'd love to see. And I know they've done a lot with Asuka. We haven't seen Asuka for a while, but I'd love to see Asuka versus Nikki A.S.H. as well. That would be terrific. But I'm taking Nikki A.S.H. to retain here. And finally, we get the main event. The head of the table, the tribal chief, the one we all should acknowledge, Roman Reigns, defending his title against John Cena. I watched this promo this week. It's unbelievable. The chemistry these two have, obviously Reigns being able to just, you know, has evolved as a promo since they first had their, I think it was back in 2017 when they had that promo before their match at No Mercy. Obviously, Reigns has evolved. Cena's still the man at promos. You know, they talked about Nikki Bella. They talked about Dean Ambrose. The only thing that would have made that promo better is if John Cena had something. You ran Dean Ambrose off of WWE, you know, something about him not being as elite as he thinks he is, you know, getting that in there. Of course, if he does that, the crowd would have probably went, AEW. But anyways, so that would have the only thing that would have made that promo better. I go back and forth on this one a lot. And I have no idea what's going to happen, which is what you want out of a main event of your major, one of your major pay-per-views of the year. I'm going to take Reigns to retain here, but that's a. This is the match I'm least confident about because I could very easily see, as a major event for the summer, them making John Cena the most decorated champion in history for a historical match, to have him win his 17th championship to become the most decorated champion in all of WWE history, surpassing Ric Flair. However, I think they're going to do Reigns versus Rollins in the fall. So maybe you could have Cena win here and then him drop the title to Reigns a month later. I'm going to take Reigns here, but that's a very, very unsecure pick. I just think there's so much momentum for the Tribal Chief right now. You can do something with Rollins, maybe do something eventually with Adam Cole, or something like that going forward. But I'm going to take Reigns here, but I'm not confident about that. And that is my predictions. No, for both Takeover and WrestleMania this week, SummerSlam, excuse me. It's going to be a tremendous weekend of wrestling action, and I can't wait for it. So those are my predictions, and this has been the Thoughts of Dericho this week. My final thought is, just enjoy the wrestling this weekend. If you're an AEW fan, enjoy Rampage and potentially the return of this most sniveling, whiny baby of all time in his hometown of Chicago. Enjoy the action with NXT TakeOver and WrestleMania. It's going to be a great, great weekend of wrestling. I hope.
This has been the Thoughts of Dericho. You're smarter now, man.